Greetings, I'm Nestor Timonidis, and I'm going to present you our work done in Radboud University for predicting the mouse mesoconnectome. So, one of the original ambitions of the Human Brain Project was to construct a large-scale cellular-level model of the human brain that could be then used to further comprehend the mechanisms of cognition and brain diseases. But for such a goal to be accomplished, adequate information about the cellular organization and the structural connectivity of the brain is needed. In our work, we focus on the mouse brain due to the fact that there exist plenty of data sources directly or indirectly related to it, which then allow us to apply multiple computational models and then, in case of being successful, are reapplied to the human brain. But the problem is that the state of the art describing the mesoconnectome in the mouse right now is inadequate to construct models because there is a lack of quantitative axonal information. It's not cell type specific. So we do not know what's happening exactly on cell types, like the connectivity strength that describes the incoming or outgoing axonal projections. For that reason, we focus on integrating multiple heterogeneous, high throughput, and brain related data sources for predicting a cell type specific mouse mesoconnectome. Initially, we selected the gene expression data taken with the in situ hybridization method, since there's a high throughput data source, and used them estimated how much connectivity information is present in gene expression by predicting connectivity data, which were sampled with the anterograde drug tracing method. Initially, both data sources were in raw format and high dimensional and thus difficult to directly analyze. And therefore, a data processing pipeline ensured that they were referenced in a common space, and then their signal intensities were averaged across all distinct brain areas, leading to a reduced two-dimensional matrix form. So if we see the gene expression matrix to the bottom left, we have a matrix where individual cells corresponds to the expression intensity for a specific gene in a given brain structure, while on the bottom right we have a binarized connectivity matrix with zeros corresponding to a lack of connection between two brain areas and one otherwise. Now, the reduction to such a simple form allows us to convert the problem to a typical supervised machine learning one, where now the connectivity structures can be broken down into individual tasks, with each task corresponding to a specific brain area kept fixed, and all its outgoing projections to other areas corresponding to patterns of 0 and 1 as shown in the middle are now predicted with the use of the gene expression matrix and the supervised machine learning algorithms, specifically two golden standards, random forest and logistic regression, while the whole predictive approach is evaluated with the accuracy measure, estimated as the total number of true positives and true negatives divided by the total number of examples in the dataset. Now, on the scatter plot to the left, all predicted results of the tasks with the logistic regression algorithm were compared to another experiment, a control group one, in which all connectivity structures were randomly permutated multiple times, thus resulting in a complete destruction of structure, noise. In every case, we see that predictive results lie above the diagonal, meaning that they exceed the control group experiment, and leads us to the observation that predictions are better than random. It's also enhanced by the box plot to the right, where for both models and for all tasks, everything exceeds at least 70%, with a median above 80%, which gives us the observation that, okay, it's better than a random assignment for the time being. A visual inspection of our predictive results using the scalable brain atlas, a 3D brain visualization tool created by my co-author Rembrandt Bakker, was done in order to understand what's happening now across brain structures, where the color map to the right corresponds to the predictive accuracy specific colors, and each area has been attributed a specific color, and we see that there is heterogeneity of predictions across brain areas. I don't know if it's shown very well, but we also see that the cortical regions are predicted on average better than subcortical ones. So initially we used in situ hybridization data, and we came to the observation that some connectivity information was present, but it's not enough. It's not cell type specific. Therefore, we need more data sources, like diffusion tensor imaging data for restricting connectivity spatially, single cell RNA sequences for adding cell type specificity, more mesoconnectomes, and also morphological or laminar related data could be useful. And therefore, all those data sources combined into a single estimate of the mesoconnectome. That's our goal. But it's kind of a more complex problem now, and typical supervised machine learning might not be adequate. And therefore, we're interested in proceeding in methods that deal with uncertainty, specifically Bayesian generative models, because examples like the infinite hidden relational model or other generative models have been used successfully in literature for dealing with complex biological datasets, networks, for example, and inferring interesting properties like predicting missing links that are present, or discovering hidden structures and reconstructing the network multiple times to understand what's going on. And moreover, new experimental techniques are becoming available day by day, and we need to keep track of them. Like this, there is, for instance, a SeenSeq technique that allows us use sequencing to discover what's the identity of pre and postsynaptic neurons, and many more. So we need to keep track of them in order to acquire better and more accurate data for the analysis. And with that, I conclude my presentation. Thank you very much for your attention.